So students, as we have seen just now, that animals show different types of movement. So movement and locomotion, what do we understand by this? Movement is a distinguishing characteristics of animals in muscle, cell contraction and amoeboid movement, that is the cellular system is based on microfilaments and all these things. So movement is a distinguished characteristics of animal that only you have to remember. Then locomotion. Locomotion means what? Locomotion means active travel from place to place. Means shifting from one place to another place, that is only locomotion. And they require energy to overcome two forces that tend to keep an animal stationary. Now, friction and gravity. So these two things are required so that they can allow movement. Although just now we have seen example of earthworm also, and earthworm, how does they walk? So that is again an example of locomotion only. So animals swim in diverse ways. Now locomotion, if I'll talk here about fish, so they swim in diverse ways. Different types of fishes swim in different ways. So one of the way is like they have streamlined motion, and that is common of all. Now example one, if you can see on the screen, that is insects use their legs as oars to push against the water. So insects which live inside the sea or ocean, they use their oars to move in the water. After that we have squids, scallops and some jellies are propelled, taking in water and squirting it out in burst. Now fishes swim by moving their body and tail from side to side. So that is again one kind of a movement which shown by fishes. So here if I'm going to mention next is like animals. If I'll talk in that, like dog, cat or whatever, they use their limbs only to walk. So a walking animal moves each leg in turn, overcoming friction between the foot and the ground with each step. Now here crawling, which I have told you just now, that is a locomotion in earthworm. You can see the structure of earthworm also. Now, animals that have no limbs or very short limbs drag their bodies along the ground in a crawling movement. Because much of the animal's body is in contact with the ground, its energy is mainly expended to overcome friction rather than gravity. Because much of the animals is in contact with the ground, its energy is mainly expended to overcome friction. Now, as you can see on the screen, that earthworm mainly find it out in soil. It is not like that when we have rain or some kind of a things, then only we can find out earthworm in the soil. Earthworm, most of the time they are present in the soil. They help to make the soil fertile. So they do not have limbs. Limbs means they do not have leg, they do not have hand. Limbs here, limbs means leg and hand. So they do not have legs or hand, but they allow movement in forward direction. Now, which allows them to move forward, that is their body structure. Their body is made up of ring-like structure. And with that ring-like structure, they have small brushes like here also, and which they will stick to the ground, and they expand their body in the front and then contract from the back, then contract from the front and then expand from the back. So this process continues and then they allow movement in front. Now if first we'll this, if you want to write it, you can write down somewhere that animals that have no limbs or very short limbs drag their body along the ground in a crawling movement. So earthworm is walking by crawling only. Then we have done snail. So snail also will come in this only. Snail will also comes in this only, that snail also allows movement by crawling only. Again, expansion and contraction is the process which they are going to follow. Then cockroaches, which we have done, cockroaches have limbs. They have three pairs of leg and they can easily walk with that. Now next is animals, birds. Major mode of animals locomotion, that is birds. Now birds have limbs also, like leg also, two pair of leg or one pair of legs, and then they have one pair of wings also. Wings are so connected with their body, with their breastbone, and the strength of their breastbone, they allow flying the bird easily in the sky. Now few animals groups like insects, reptile, including birds also, among the mammals and bats. Cockroaches also have wings. Cockroaches, which we have done just now, they also have wings. So birds, they have one pair of wings, and which allows movement in different directions and quite easy, since they have hollow bones in their wings, and which is light in weight. And these wings were so connected with their body, like with their breastbone, and these hollow bones allow movement easily. So easily they fly, and then they show locomotion or movement. Now locomotion, loco means when location will be in motion. When motion changed its location, that is locomotion. So it is none other than movement only. So children, do not get confused that locomotion ma'am is doing something else. So it is not something else. Locomotion is yet another word for movement only. Movement, birds, animals, insects, they are showing movement, and that movement change their location, change their place. That is why that movement is known as locomotion. So we'll come to next. How they will be easily fly in the sky, or what type of skeleton they have. Since earthworm do not have bones, do not have limbs, so their structure we are not going to, skeleton we are not going to mention. But skeleton functions in support, movement and protection. So what is the function of skeleton? That is, there are three main types of skeleton. That is hydrostatic skeleton, exoskeleton and endoskeleton. Hydrostatic skeleton, how does they work? Hydrostatic skeleton, how does they work? That we will understand, right? Skeleton is a must for a body of a bird, insect or animal, that they provide the proper shape to the body of a bird, to the body of a movement and protection of it. Now, three main types of skeleton, that is hydrostatic skeleton, exoskeleton and endoskeleton. So hydrostatic, exoskeleton and endoskeleton, that we are going to understand about. These type of skeleton we will find it out. Now, skeleton is very important. As I told you, different parts of our body, different parts of a skeleton of our body, and how they are important all. So hydrostatic skeleton, that is consist of fluid held under pressure in a closed body compartment. So consist of fluid held under pressure in a closed body compartment. So in some of the insects you will find it out that fluid is present in their body, and that fluid also secrete and allows movement to that insect. So that is that comes in hydrostatic skeleton. Now these skeleton, these animals or these insects can easily walk with the help of these jelly-like substance which is filled in their body. Like here I am going to take example of earthworm also. As you can see two diagrams here, that is again insects which is having fluid-like structure filled with in their body. So the fluid which is filled in their body, that kind of a skeleton is known as hydrostatic skeleton. Now they help protect other body parts by cushioning them from shocks, and it also gives the body shape and provides support for muscle action. They help protect other body part by cushioning them from shock, and it also gives the body shape and provides support for muscle action. So these all things are very important. Go through all these slides, and if you want to write like hydrostatic skeleton, what are the function of hydrostatic skeleton and what is the importance of this type of skeleton, that you all can find it out. Now there here it is, the like hydrostatic skeleton, fluid is consist inside it, and then under pressure in a closed body compartment, they help protect other body part by cushioning them from shocks, and it also gives the body shape and provides support for muscle action. So that all it happens here. Now we'll come to next, that is exoskeleton. Exoskeleton, that is rigid. Exo means outside, the skeleton which is present outside the body of that animal, that is rigid. External skeleton, exoskeleton is rigid external skeleton. Characteristics of the phylum Arthropoda, a group that includes insects, spider and crustacean such as crabs. So these insects, spider and crabs have this exoskeleton. And what is the characteristics that includes insects, spider and this, that is such as crabs. So the same characteristics were there of all these three insects which have this this type of exoskeleton. Exoskeleton they have. So now next is endoskeleton, the skeleton which is present inside their body. Consist of hard and leathery supporting element situated among the soft tissues of an animal. So here we have done three types of skeleton, that is hydrostatic skeleton, exoskeleton and endo. Endo means inside, inside the body. The skeleton which is found inside the body, that is your endoskeleton. So endoskeleton we will be finding in the inside of insects, and that is responsible for supporting elements also. So all these endoskeleton is very important. Endoskeleton which is present inside the insects is very important. Now skeleton plays an important role like hydrostatic skeleton, the insects which have hydrostatic skeleton, their fluid help them to allow movement. Similarly, in exoskeleton, the skeleton which is present outside the body of animal, they support them, they provide a proper shape to them, they provide strength to them. So that will be there. Now, vertebrate skeleton, that is our human body skeleton, that is the whole part is not required to do it. The vertebrate skeleton, means we have this whole skeleton of our body, different part, above one is skull, then we have the rib cage, then we have bony structure of hand, arm, then hip bone, and different. So this whole structure, although we have already done, here you can pause the video and you can zoom it, and then you can find it out the different part of it. So as you can see on the screen, here above we were talking about skull, then we have vertebrae or vertebras, then rib cage here, then we have hand bone, and then we have leg bone. So different part, femur, the thigh bone, the other name of thigh bone. It is not necessary to remember all these parts, but some of the part you can go through it. So now all vertebrates have an axial skeleton supporting the axis or trunk of the body. Now it consists of skull, vertebral column, backbone, and in most vertebrates, rib cage is important. So you just go through all these skeleton which we have done. Like axial skeleton is mostly find it out in human being. That is consist of skull, vertebral column, backbone, and in most vertebrates we have rib cage also. So that is consist of skull, vertebral column and all. And go through that. I hope there is no doubt in this type of skeleton. So that is type of skeleton is quite clear to you all. Axial skeleton supporting the axis or trunk of the body. Consists of skull, vertebral column, and in most vertebrates we have rib cage. So this axial skeleton, we found it out in humans. And we will be discussing this axial skeleton later. Today, we have done few things that you all are going to revise. That is types of skeleton and locomotion. That is movement. How they show and what kind of a movement they show. That we have done. You just go through the movement of animals, insects. That is very important. And you will be finding that what kind of a movement they show, that is very, very important in this chapter. You just go through it, and if you find it out, any issue, any problem, any doubt, that will be shared in the class, that will be detailed in the class. So here today I am going to finish the class. You just go through the slides, you will finding some important points which you can jot down somewhere. And if you don't, you just go through it. These pictures, these diagrams will help you understand a lot. That is why I'm taking these pictures, since this whole skeleton, this body movement we have done in the bookish form only. So that is why I'm taking all these pictures. So that's all for today, children. Have a good day. Here one more thing, if you will find it out that anything which is important in the slides, you can jot down somewhere, you can write down as a definition also. So then doubt will be taking in the class itself, and whatever will be doubt that can be clear. So bye bye. So students, we understood about the movement, different types of movement, as like earthworm allows movement in their body due to muscles contraction and expansion. So muscle contraction and movement, how they goes hand in hand, that we do understand now. Now muscle contraction and movement, the skeleton and muscle interacts in movement. Since in the body of earthworm we find it out, that is the earthworm is expanding its front, then contraction is there in the rear end, and then again expanding the rear end, and then contraction will be there in the front end. So muscle contraction and movement is very important in the skeleton, not only in animals, in a human being also it is very important. The skeleton and muscle interacts in movement. Now muscles are connected to bones by tendons. There are certain parts, there are certain important things that is related to it. That is, muscles are connected to bones by tendons. Now what are tendons? Tendons are the soft muscles which are present inside the your hands. So there are two types of muscles which are present in your bone, sorry, in your hand, that is in your upper arm, that is biceps and triceps. So I'll be talking about the muscles. So first I'll be starting with the human being only. That human being is having two types of muscles in the upper arm, that is biceps and triceps. Now biceps contracted, then triceps relaxed or extended, then tricep contracted, then bicep relaxed. So that will allow movement whenever, like when you are holding anything in your hand, these muscles like biceps and triceps plays an important role in contraction and movement of their body. So biceps and triceps very very important. Go through it. Biceps is the upper bone and triceps is the lower bone. Under the bone, the muscles which are present under the bone, that is your triceps, biceps and then triceps. Now biceps are the muscles which are present in your upper bone. If you will make a feast of your hand and then you will make your hand in that movement, you will be finding that it can be feel in our body, these bicep and tricep which allows movement in your upper arm, that can be feel in your body. So very important this muscle contraction which allows movement. Now each muscle cell has its own contractile apparatus. Now a muscle consists of many bundles of muscle fibers. Roughly here the number of muscle fibers is 250,000 in a typical human bicep muscles, oriented parallel to each other, oriented parallel to each other. That is 250,000 muscles which are present, they are oriented parallel to each other. These muscles are connected in such a way that is they are working like a helping hand to each other, and then only they allows movement. Now each muscle has its own contractile apparatus. Contractile apparatus means there each muscles has its own way of contraction and expansion. Here we will be discussing about the animals also and the human being also. Human being also they have different types of ways to contract and expand muscles. So our muscle consists of many bundles of muscle fibers, that is roughly 250,000 in a typical human bicep muscles. Oriented parallel, what is the orientation of these muscles? That is parallel to each other. Parallel muscle we will be getting there. So I hope there is no doubt in this contraction and expansion. Now here is certain few more terms, that is discrete bundle of protein that include the contractile protein, that is actin and myosin. Myosin and actin, you no need to remember it, but you must remember like what are the different discrete bundles of protein which are present, and that include contractile protein, actin and myosin and all. Sarcomere is the region between two dark narrow lines called Z lines in the myofibril. Each myofibril consists of a long series of a sarcomeres. Now functionally the sarcomere is the contractile apparatus. In a myofibril, the muscle fiber fundamental unit of action. Now thin filaments which are present in your muscles composed primarily of actin molecules. Now thick filaments which are made up of myosin molecules. Now thick filament that is known as myosin, and thin filament that is known as actin. So these filaments which are present here, like thin and thick filaments, they are composed primarily of actin molecules. Then thick filaments which are made up of myosin molecules. All these molecules are very important, and they composed primarily of actin molecules only, which are made up of myosin molecules. So thin filaments as well as thick filaments, both are important in between your muscles. A muscle contracts when thin filament slides along thick filaments. Now they are working like a slider. Now sliding filament model of a muscle contraction, a sarcomere contraction or shorten when its thin filament slides along its thick filaments. Now thin filament slides into it when thick filaments meet with it. So it will slide inside and then it will be formed. Now again, relaxed muscles, you can find it out with this diagram. Then contracting muscles, then fully contracted muscles. So that is why you can feel the muscles in your upper arm. In your upper arm you can feel that muscles. Why is it so? Since that muscles contracted or placed over there only. So that is their dark band, then contracted sarcomere. So this diagram will help you to understand that how muscles are contract on a particular place, how they are contracted with each other. So I hope now it is clear to you all, like muscle contraction and all, thin filaments and everything related to our muscles, and how these muscles allow movement. Muscle contraction and expansion is important only for the movement only. How movement is possible if we have this contraction or expansion. So just go through this video as well as what kind of a movement is allowed, what kind of a skeleton we find it out in different insects. That you just go through it. And if you find any problem, any issue, that will be discussed in the online class. Now muscle contraction and movement, that is the skeleton and the muscle interacts in movement. Now muscles are connected to bones by tendons. By tendons it will be created. So muscles fibers, they are about roughly 250,000 or 250,000 in a typical human bicep muscles, oriented parallel to each other. They were placed parallel to each other. So that is quite clear to you all. Now I'll be finishing the class here, and we will be meeting in the next class with another topic of this. So of this chapter, that is movement, we have already finished movement of different animals. Like one more important thing here we have seen, like Python has 400 bones. So fine, that's all for today, children. Have a good day.